Very good afternoon to everyone. Myself, Dr. Prakash Suvasia. I am from HORIBA Medical, and we have holding this webinar currently with Dr. Sanjay Arora and Dr. Neelam Verma, who will be speaking on the diagnostic challenges and lab safety from an Indian perspective. So Dr. Sanjay Arora would be talking on sample management and testing challenges in COVID-19 infections, his experiences till date, as his lab has been given the recommendations and clearance by ICMR to conduct the testing. So over to you, sir. Now you can start with your presentations.
So Prakash, you want me to start from the beginning again or stop from where we stopped?
From sir, we can start here from.
From here again?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, so welcome back, everybody. I think some of you may have already heard the first part, but I'll just repeat and I'll go fast. You know, there's so much of information overload that has already happened. So what I'll be doing today is sharing my experience of, you know, testing coronavirus at Suburban Diagnostics. I want to start by, you know, thanking HORIBA for giving me this chance to be here, for being able to share this platform with Dr. Neelam, you know, who's a very respected speaker. I want to acknowledge my team, Dr. Anupa, Dr. Shweta, Dr. Hina, Edison, Rajesh, Minuti, and Veena for, you know, creating all the back-end processes and helping me with this presentation as well. I also wanted to share with the team that, you know, we've had Dr. Amardas Gupta, who has joined us as the medical director from 1st of April. So he's part of the Suburban Diagnostics family. We got permission to do the coronavirus testing from ICMR on 22nd of March. And what I'll be doing is I'll be sharing our hands-on experience over the last 10 days with you, rather than, you know, try and, you know, repeat what already is being circulated various, you know, emails or social media. Just to, you know, share the classification of where the coronavirus lies as part of the neurovirus family. And there are these four subtypes: alpha, beta, gamma, and delta. This slide basically, you know, shows, you know, where what's the structure of the coronavirus, and like any other virus, it has, you know, an envelope protein which is E, a spike protein which is S, and a membrane glycoprotein which is M. Now these are the target sites for testing. The bottom right hand side shows, you know, how there is a genomic overlap with other viruses and the bat, but there are some you know, specific areas which we will show in later slides, which are specific only to the novel coronavirus, which is used to confirm the presence of the virus. We also see that even though the virus is extremely small, but because it is expelled in droplets, you know, we are protected because the size of the droplets are larger than the pores of the mask. So we are still protected from that. As I said, that when we, you know, started testing, you know, we were sure that there would be a huge demand, and we wanted to make sure that we did testing, you know, as long as we had enough kits. So to filter out those people who genuinely need, you know, ICMR, inspired by WHO, has set some guidelines that, you know, people who have traveled and are symptomatic, traveled overseas in the last 2 weeks and are symptomatic, people who have come in contact with lab confirmed individuals, all symptomatic healthcare workers, of course, people who are hospitalized and have acute respiratory illness definitely qualify. And the last category is people who are asymptomatic and may have come in contact with a you know, known positive. They should be tested generally at least 5 days after coming in contact, because you know, you might risk getting a false negative if you do it before 5 days, and not more than 14 days. Some of the requirements, you know, and this has kept changing, and thankfully in our favor, that we don't need any special conditions to collect the sample. I think just a closed room, a door, you know, is enough, which is fairly well ventilated. And to make sure that just the technician who is doing the test and the patient or maximum one more attendant should be present. We don't want too many people in that room. We need to have a special collection kit which consists of two swabs and viral transport medium. A disposable tongue depressor is required. You need PPE, and I will give you details of the PPE as we go along, which is a personal protective equipment. Of course, hand sanitizers are required, and biomedical waste. You know, this is a very specific requirement that ICMR and WHO have given us. So biomedical waste becomes extremely important. So what we have done at Suburban Diagnostics, we have given people two options. We have created 8 dedicated centers where patients can come and, you know, give their samples. But we also built a team of what we call as COVID warriors, people who go home and do home collection. Initially there was a lot of fear among the staff that, you know, there's so much of hype created around the coronavirus. So we had to, you know, create a lot of a training program for them, you know, show how to use the PPE, and to overcome their fear. We also made sure that, you know, we gave them prophylactic hydroxychloroquine to make sure that, you know, they have that level of protection as recommended by ICMR. Despite all this, you know, there's a lot of stigma in society, and, you know, this is because of the lockdown situation. Police and the local authorities make it difficult for us to travel. But despite all that, you know, my team has stuck on and, you know, continue to do about 200 to 250 tests every day. We've also had challenges with, you know, delays in stock. So PPEs and masks are always short supplied. And of course, because of the lockdown situation, you know, there's always a challenge of getting adequate manpower. The commonest sample that, as recommended by ICMR is, there are two swabs that we need to take. One is a nasopharyngeal swab, and second is an oropharyngeal swab. And there are specific guidelines that need to be followed. And all our COVID warriors or people who do the collection have been trained on this by SOPs that have been prepared looking at WHO and CDC guidelines. Bronchoalveolar or lavage or sputum samples are also recommended, and I will show you a slide subsequently on what is the percentage of positivity based on the sample type. The swabs that I mentioned are nylon swabs, and we have a viral transport medium in which the swabs must be transported. There is appropriate hand sanitizers in between, you know, every step. Biomedical waste, as I mentioned, and of course you have to swab down the area after doing the collection with 1% sodium hypochlorite. Once the sample has been collected, it has to be transported in a triple seal pack. So we have 3 layers. So the first is, you know, adsorbent material like cotton or tissue paper, and that is put in a Ziploc pouch, which is then put into a sturdy plastic container, and which is then put into a cardboard box. And all this is then, you know, put with hard frozen gel packs, because you need to maintain a temperature of 2 to 8 degrees, and the virus is generally stable for up to 24 to 48 hours if you are able to keep it within 2 to 8 degrees. So these kind of, you know, precautions need to be maintained to transport the sample. As I was mentioning earlier, that if you look at this slide, this is something which has been shown as an experience globally, and based on experience from China, that nasal swabs are more sensitive than the oral swabs, 60 to 70% sensitivity. Sputum has a slightly higher sensitivity, and of course, bronchoalveolar lavage is the highest, which is at 93%. We had a case where on day one, the nasal swab came negative, but because there was a high suspicion, we repeated the test on day two with sputum. And the test actually came positive. So sometimes we actually have seen this in our own experience, that sample site makes a big difference also. PPE or personal protective equipment becomes integral to the whole process of sample collection. And we want to make sure that, you know, our staff is well protected, because only if we can keep our staff protected can they, you know, perform their duties with, you know, without fear. So it's important that we give them, you know, gloves to protect their hands. There's a full gown, you know, from head to toe, including a shoe cover, there's a separate hair cover. And of course, there is a mask along with goggles of or face shields. We have used goggles. PPE needs to be assembled for every home visit. Whereas if it's a center visit, we can make do with two or three PPEs in one session. We've faced a lot of challenge in getting supplies for these PPEs. Our procurement team has worked tirelessly. You know, there was one vendor who was able to give us the entire set completely packed, but mostly we have to buy them separately and then assemble them ourselves. Then there's a specific process of putting on the PPE, which is called donning, and then removing it, which is called doffing. So as you can see on the slide, you know, there's a, you know, you put the gloves, then the shoe cover, then the full gown, then the mask, the goggles, the hair cover, and then you put in a pair of gloves. And while removing it, in each step, in between each step, you have to use hand sanitizers. So after you remove one pair of gloves, put the hand sanitizer. When you remove the overall, again, you, you know, remove and you use your hand sanitizer to, you know, apply on your gloved hands. So this is a process that has to be followed. And, you know, we've used a training, which was initially carried on in person, but later on we've used digital technology, you know, to, you know, spread this awareness of training. We have a digital platform called Upside LMS, and videos on how to, you know, use the PPE, how to wear it, how to remove it have been uploaded so that our staff can, you know, refer to it as when they need. It's very important that, you know, when we get a request for doing a COVID test, you know, not all cases which are acute respiratory will only be COVID. So sometimes we get a combination that, you know, can we also do an H1N1 test? Can we do a respiratory biofire panel? Or can we also look for sputum cultures, you know, could be routine or any other cultures. So this, you know, a syndromic approach is something which is also catching attention as we go along. I'll share with, you know, what type of testing that we are using. Before that, just to show you this busy slide, as I had shown you the initial structure, the S protein, the M protein, and the E protein. These are the target sites. And this is sort of the pathogenesis. You know, the S protein is what attaches to the ACE receptors, and we know what impact that can cause. So this is the sort of pathogenesis of the various different protein structures and how they cause pathogen, you know, the pathology within the lungs. The test recommended for diagnosis and confirmation is a nucleic acid amplification test by RT-PCR. And if required, we can always do a confirmation later on by sequencing, but that is currently not recommended. The E gene, which is specific to the coronavirus family, is the screening gene. And there are specific sites, as I mentioned earlier in the first slide, the N, S, ORF1, and the RDRP genes. These are specific genes which are only found in the novel coronavirus. So it's a combination of the screening gene and one of these specific genes that confirms the diagnosis of COVID-19 or coronavirus. And this extraction of the RNA has to be done in biosafety, you know, level 2 sites, which we have. And of course, QC, both internal and external, is an integral part of this process. So this is the experience that we have had with the three kits that we have used in Suburban. All these kits either have to have an ICMR approval or have to have a US FDA or a CE IVD, you know, approval. So the first kit that we used was the Altona kit. This is a German kit, which is a one tube assay, which uses the envelope antigen and the S gene, you know, S protein as a combination. So if both E and S are positive, then it's confirming the, you know, the coronavirus, the novel coronavirus. Whereas if E is positive and S is negative, it's talking about this, you know, the SIBO coronavirus is positive, but not the novel, the COV2 is not a positive in that case. So you could say for COVID-19, it is negative. My lab is a 3-tube assay, which is an Indian company, which has been approved by ICMR, which looks at the E and the RDRP, you know, target sites. They have only one interpretation that both E and RDRP have to be positive and to call it a COV2 positive or a COVID-19 positive. We've also used the Siemens kit, which is CE-IVD approved. Combination of a screening and a confirmatory, combination is required to confirm the presence of COVID-19 or novel coronavirus. The ORF1 and the N gene are other confirmatory targets, whereas, the RDRP and S genes are the one which are more specific. So most companies that we have used use either the S or the RDRP target sites. Currently, we started by running 2 batches, but of course, this has gone out of the window because of the logistics of supply of the kits. We started with 1 Ultra kit, then we had to go to my lab, and then we had Siemens, and now we are trying to juggle between all 3, whichever one we get. There has been a much higher demand than the supply. We are always facing a challenge of supply of kits, but I'm happy to say as of today, we have adequate supply of both the MyLab kits as well as the Siemens kits, which will allow us to, be able to maintain the TAT of within 24 hours. The actual processing time, that is extraction and, the amplification takes about 6 hours, but the whole end-to-end process from collecting the sample to reaching one of our centers, till it, comes to our molecular lab, then the accessioning, so it takes a lot of time, and then we have to batch it all together. So as I mentioned that ICMR has allowed us, either they have approved kits which have been approved at NIV in Pune, or if they have a US FDA or a CE stamp. So that's what the process that we are following currently at Suburban. Any positive result has to be rechecked. So we make sure that every positive result goes into a rerun, and we make sure that happens. We also have to have a concordance study done. So Kasturba Hospital in Mumbai is the government approved site. So we had sent about 20 samples, and ours was one of the first labs to be approved because all our tests were in concordance with their QC. We are also pooling our samples and sending the positive samples to NIV for as per the ICMR protocol. But it's very important to know that just because a test is negative, it does not rule out COVID-19 infection. And there are some reasons why you should not rule it out. One is that, as I said, there's limitation of the specimen itself. Even if it's a good specimen, there is limitation, but sometimes the quality of the specimen may not be up to the mark. If you collect the sample too early or too late, if it is before 5 days or after 14 days, you may miss it. Handling and shipping and the right temperature, that is extremely important. And of course, rare things like mutation, which we are still trying to evaluate. And I gave you the example of a case where there was very high index of suspicion. The swabs came negative, but the sputum sample came positive. So these conditions need to be kept in mind before we rule out a negative. Just this morning, I got an update from my lab team that, ICMR has introduce the testing for antibodies. Now, I'm still a little unsure how this is going to be used, because we know that, the IgG, IgM antibodies will be developed, much later, at least after 2 weeks from, the incubation, after 2 weeks of, exposure. So I personally feel that this could be more used to look at the immune status or herd immunity, or a retrospective analysis, may not be used as a diagnostic tool, especially not in the first 2 weeks. So we'll wait to see how ICMR gives further guidelines. Currently, kits of these tests are still being procured. There are different manufacturers who have promised to provide these kits. The advantage here is that, of course, these are just blood samples, and We can collect it from a blood sample, but we don't know how effective it will be. I still feel that a PCR test, you know, is a more sensitive diagnostic test, whereas an antibody test will be more looking at the immune status of. So the other advantage of the antibody test that I see is that if a healthcare worker has developed antibodies, then he and she, you know, can actually go back to work because they have developed the immunity. So I think that will be a very important aspect of the antibody testing. We are also preserving all our positive samples at minus 70. And we're looking at if we can collaborate with somebody to do, you know, sequencing so that we can pick up the mutations that are prevalent in the Indian population. And if those mutations offer some sort of resistance to the virus, unlike the other areas, there was some hypothesis that in areas where malaria is endemic, you know, the coronavirus is not as effective and vice versa. So we want to see if we can, you know, collate all our positive samples, do some sequencing and find some mutations which can help us, you know, predict, you know, future epidemiological studies. There are few, you know, general lab tests, you know, that could be of use. And these are some data which has come from Italy and from China that, you know, almost everything goes up, whether it's your WBC count or your LDH or SGOT, SGPT, troponins, procalcitonin, CRP, but your lymphocyte count and your albumin goes down. So these are, you know, some general indicators for patients who have already been tested positive and you want to assess the progression of them, you know, after they have been admitted. You know, one important complication of the coronavirus is the cytokine storm. And we know that, you know, the immune system is actually meant to protect us from any, you know, invaders. But here, the immune system actually goes out of control. And there is a, you know, a hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis reaction, which takes place. You know, you get high fever, you get cytopenias. And a very important element in that is elevated ferritin. Some data from China showed that, you know, ferritin, which was close to 1,300 value, showed a much worse prognosis as compared to values which were half of that. So ferritin in, you know, severely ill cases can actually predict progression, whether it's favorable or unfavorable. This is still last night. You know, we have done about close to 1,700 test collections, of which about 3/4 are home visits and the rest are center visits and hospital visits. All our data has to be shared with, you know, the local authorities, that is the MCGM and ICMR. They will collate data from all the labs and then they will be the ones to share the positivity. All I can share at this point of time is that initially, when we started, we found that the positivity rate was very high. Of course, our sample size was much smaller. But as time has progressed, I'm happy to tell you and share with you that the positivity rate has actually come down. And it is, you know, I think the lockdown that the government has enforced and well supported by the public is actually helping contain the virus. So the incidence of positivity is going down with time. So that's a favorable, you know, feedback for everybody at the end. These were some of my experiences that I wanted to share. Once again, thank you, Prakash and HORIBA, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for your time and enlightening us and sharing your experiences in a very short duration of time. And we all know the information is yet to come. The robust data would take almost like 3 to 5 years again to lay down certain correct guidelines. Right. And I can see many of the cases coming up day to day. And what we hear is we are actually in a scoop, whether this it's all about like false positivity or negativity, which is all we get from WhatsApps or say what figures we are getting. But thank you so much for sharing your experience. And I could collect a lot of questions from the chat, which to the audiences who are listening to us, we will be having a QA session after the second presentation is over. So be online and share your experiences more and more so that we understand this current pandemicity in more details. So now the second speaker for the day, I'd like to introduce Dr. Neelam Verma ma'am, who is professor and head department of hematology, PGI Chandigarh, the most renowned institute, which we all desired to go and work there sometime. And madam being so much of a prestigious in the institute, she has been associated with many government agencies also. Especially what we all know, they also have catering to ICMR projects and all. So I would like to call upon Dr. Neelam Verma ma'am to talk upon diagnostic challenges and recommendations in COVID-19 infections in a government setup, because right now we heard something which is related to the private sector of the laboratory. Over to you, ma'am. You can take the presentation.
Thank you, Prakash. Hello, everybody. So, thank you for the invitation, and it's high time that we start discussing about the strategies to face COVID-19. The issue that I'm going to touch upon during my presentation are the testing recommendations for diagnosis of COVID-19, auxiliary additional lab biomarkers in management of COVID-19 positive cases, and lastly, the testing challenges in phase 3 after outbreak. So the case definition, I think by now all of us remember these indications when to suspect COVID-19 cases. All this is all over the WhatsApp and all over the electronic or print media. So the first 3 points, the person who's had an international travel in the last 14 days and all symptomatic contacts of laboratory confirmed cases or all symptomatic healthcare persons, they were there to begin with in the recommendations from ICMR. And then we were talking about looking at our patient cohorts, that how come we are not testing for cases which are beyond these 3 points. So, and lo and behold, the recent recommendations dated 31st of March, these additional parameters, additional pointers were also included in the recommendations. So now we are testing, we are suspecting COVID in all hospitalized patients with severe acute respiratory illness, people who are having fever and cough and or shortness of breath, as well as asymptomatic, direct, and high risk contacts of a confirmed case. And the symptoms, we all know, we are looking for fever, cough, shortness of breath. Direct and high risk contacts include those who live in the same household with a confirmed case and healthcare personnel who examined a confirmed case. The confirmed case is supposed to be having a laboratory confirmation of COVID-19 infection with or without clinical signs and symptoms. So we have to take care of all these 5 points when to suspect. And then once we have a confirmed case, we have these 2 categories, suspect and confirmed COVID-19 cases. We are all well aware of the guidance or the recommendations, suggestions coming from the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. These are being updated on a daily basis. And there is a swift change from one end to another to include all the evolving parameters. So sample collection, I think I missed some of the presentation of Dr. Arora. But I guess that he's covered these, that the sample collection, the preferred samples are the throat and nasal swab in viral transport media, and it has to be transported on ice. This point is very important. The general guidelines have to be adhered to. The trained healthcare professionals have to wear appropriate PPE, maintain proper infection control when collecting samples. There has to be a restricted entry to visitors or attendants during the sample collection. The clinical colleagues have to complete the requisition form for each specimen submitted. there has to be a proper disposal of all waste generated. So it's good to have a sample from upper respiratory tract as well as lower respiratory tract, ideally. But whatever sample we get from the clinical side, we have to process them. And then depending on the clinical picture, clinical condition of the patient, the decision is taken about the routine or specialized diagnostic samples to be sent in these patients. What we are practicing in PGI, and I'm sure the same thing is being done in elsewhere also, that we all understand that there is a urgent requirement of other specific laboratory investigations. In that setting, when the clinical condition of the patient demands like that, then clinicians should first discuss with the designated nodal officer, either on telephone or through WhatsApp or whatever, saying that these are the tests required and I'm going to send this kind of samples. All the relevant details should be filled up in the requisition form, and this should definitely include the mention whether patient is a confirmed COVID-19 case or a suspected COVID-19 case or not. This is very important. The laboratory biosafety parameters, measures have to be taken care of. All the procedures must be performed based on risk assessment and only by personnel with demonstrated capability. And we have to follow a pre-decided SOP at all times. Initial processing before inactivation of the virus. So initial processing of all specimens should be done in a validated biological safety cabinet or primary containment device. Non-propagative diagnostic laboratory work, which includes sequencing and NAT, this should be conducted at a biosafety level 2 facility. Propagative work, which includes viral culture, isolation, or neutralization assays, these should be conducted at a containment laboratory with BSL-3 facility. Appropriate disinfectants should be used, different concentration for different purposes, but appropriate disinfectants have to be used. Patient specimens from suspected or confirmed cases should be transported according to the WHO biosafety guidance regarding good microbiological procedures and packaging recommendations. In PGI, last month, all the concerned departments got together and we decided on SOPs which we made for our institute. So these have been developed for sample collection, transportation, and processing of samples collected from suspected or confirmed patients of COVID-19. And these SOPs were prepared keeping in view various national and WHO guidelines available online. There is a danger of aerosol generation during processing of clinical samples. Therefore, present SOPs have been designed to minimize the risk of healthcare workers and the laboratory staff involved in the care of these people. All good laboratory practices such as proper hand washing, etc., has to be followed. So these one general framework of the SOP was made, and then different departments like virology, microbiology, biochemistry, hematology, we all made little modifications to the SOP depending on the kind of sample that we are handling. Whether we are going to open the sample container in a biosafety cabinet, or we don't have to open the lid of the vacutainer at all. So that makes a lot of difference what kind of precautions we are going to take. The cleaning of the Ziploc pouch has to be there. The samples have to be transported in a triple layer container. And then we have to decide about the workflow of the sample. So once we decided the SOPs, then we went through a mock drill before handling the real samples, so that starting from the collection of the sample, how the sample is going to be packaged, how the sample is going to be handed over to attendant from the ward, and how that person is going to bring the sample to the lab in a designated area, and so on. So all that is pre-decided, mock drills, good to do that, and then start dealing with the real sample. So Dr. Arora did mention about the virology testing. So that's what our virology colleagues are also doing, that they are first doing the screening assay, which involves the E gene assay, and then the when it comes positive, then confirmatory assay is performed using the ORF or the RP gene targeting. So currently, the RT-PCR probes for diagnosis of COVID-19 are procured from USA by ICMR NIV and distributed to testing laboratories across the country. I think Dr. Arora did mention about that. And then, as we know, keeping in mind our population and the kind of number of patients and the number of samples that we are expected to handle, the requirement of the kits is very, very huge. So in addition to the US FDA approved kits, the ICMR NIV is welcoming the use of non-US FDA or EUA approved kits to be used. So till 24th of March, there were 14 kits which were tested, and as mentioned earlier, Eltona kits from Eltona, my lab, and C-Gene companies, they showed 100% concordance, so they are good to go with the testing. And by 31st of March, six more kits were evaluated, and that showed up that two more kits, the C-Gene kit and the SD biosensor kit, rather three more kits, have shown 100% concordance with the positive and negative samples. So which is a good news that we have more number of kits available, we can use a wider range of the kits. So that was about the testing recommendations. Then I come to the next point that I am supposed to touch upon, the auxiliary and additional lab biomarkers in management. So as we know that asymptomatic persons can be left alone, the symptomatic, quarantined, or people kept in the isolation wards, patients, they need to be tested. And a host of, I think, more than 14-15 lab parameters were mentioned earlier. So, but depending on the kind of testing that we are doing, additional lab testing, that has to be decided depending on the clinical picture of the patient. So appropriate test needs to be done. And like Dr. Arora mentioned about lymphopenia and raised LDH or ferritin or procalcitonin and things like that. Ferritin, D-dimer, also people, some studies have shown the usefulness of D-dimers or platelet lymphocyte ratio also. So ultimately we need to decide, prognosticate which patients are going to do well and which patients are not going to do so well. So patients who are requiring ICU kind of care or versus patients who are not going to require non-ICU, not going to require ICU kind of care. It's good to decide that in order to prognosticate these patients. That's very reassuring. If we know that a person is not going to require ICU care, it's good for the patient and good for the healthcare workers as well. Testing challenges in phase three after this outbreak are many, as we all understand. I'm just showing here one publication which appeared on 4th of March this year, and this is a work from Singapore where they performed ELISA assays. So they standardized it. They designed this ELISA assay for the antibody profiling, and they checked for IgM antibodies, IgG antibodies, and IgA antibodies, and compared it with the PCR test positivity. So positive detection rate was significantly increased to the tune of 98% when IgM ELISA assay was combined with PCR for each patient, compared to a low figure of about 52% when a single real-time PCR was done, which is something that it's definitely adding to the overall value. But the flip side was that nearly 22% of the patients who were confirmed to be positive by real-time PCR were found to be negative by the IgM antibody test. So there it goes for a toss, that we can't depend on one test alone. We have to use the RT-PCR test definitely, and we have to make a judgment call on the utility of antibody testing too. So on 28 March, this was the scene that ICMR recommendation was that the rapid antibody kits for COVID-19, they are not recommended for diagnosis of COVID-19 infection. They can be done on blood, serum, plasma samples. Test result is available within 30 minutes. It's a point of care test. Test comes positive after 7 to 10 days of infection. Test remains positive for several weeks after infection. Positive test indicates exposure to the virus. Negative test does not rule out COVID-19 infection. So these tests not recommended. Then, as was mentioned by the earlier speaker, now we have this recommendation which came yesterday only, that population in hot spots may be tested using rapid antibody test. The antibody positivity to be confirmed by RT-PCR using throat nasal swab. Antibody negative to be quarantined at home. A list of CE-marked rapid SARS-CoV-2 antibody test is available. And these kits can be used directly after due approval from DCGI and intimation to ICMR. So this recommendation has come. Maybe it will be useful in certain circumstances. So then I come to the testing challenges in our scenario. So we know the kind of country we live in. Huge population is there, and the containment was quite acceptable, quite good actually, under the leadership of our Prime Minister, and it showed some positive trends. But now the widespread movement of suspected and confirmed COVID-19 patients has complicated the picture definitely. So that means we can expect a splurge of many more positive cases now, which is happening actually. We are already more than 2,000 positive cases so far. So the decision about whom to test or not to test is a very tricky one. But I think we, for the time being, go by those five pointers that I mentioned in my second slide or so. The availability of testing kits is a major, major issue. Maybe things would improve with the availability or the good-to-go non-US FDA-approved kits. But then we have to understand that there are issues with any kind of test. We can have false positive, false negative results, and we have to be careful about those. The availability of trained manpower and the certified lab facilities, that is a major issue in our country. I remember looking at a WhatsApp message today, someone had posted that you can make these kits or the personal protective equipments in 1 or 2 months, but it takes many, many years to train a doctor or other healthcare workers. So, which is a reality, and we all have to understand that and try to ensure the safety of the healthcare workers. We are there to help these patients. We are there, it's our duty to help all the patients. These days, the corona, COVID-19 patients, but we can only do our duty if we take care of ourselves. If our workforce gets affected adversely, we won't be there in enough number to take care of the job at hand. So I think that's it. Yes. Thank you very much. So any questions?
So thank you so much, ma'am, for putting in highlights on the challenges, what has been done, and the newer policies and the strategies made by the government agencies. And after this session, I would like to call upon Dr. Arora as well as a panel member for the questions, because I have been gathering all the questions coming up on the chat, trying to make it as an like a common questionnaire, so that we can ask for both of them. So there is one question for Dr. Arora, which is what I could gather from the sample collection and the management topic. So many of them are asking, what are there any special recommendations or measures or any guidelines which has been given for any routine testing of the patient who are COVID positive? Like, if do we need to have any special recommendation for handling a urine sample or a blood sample in hematology lab or in biochemistry? There was one question also, like, do we need to use a separate centrifugation for biochemistry samples if we know that this patient is COVID positive? Arora, sorry.
No, good questions, Prakash. So whatever little information that we have, we know that the virus definitely is present in the fecal matter for sure. So far, our experience has been that any patient who has got tested for COVID 19, if they are tested positive, they get admitted to a hospital which has an isolation ward. And I think further investigations are then conducted in a hospital setup. We don't have any specific guidelines because we don't have any experience of handling any COVID positive patients who have come back and done any tests with us. Maybe Dr. Neelam might be in a better position to answer that, because in a hospital setup, they would be seeing a lot of positive patients, and if they have any specific handling conditions for, you know, the biochemistry samples. I know definitely fecal matter shows positivity for the virus and it needs to be handled separately. What we do in our lab is that we have given glove and masks to everybody. Every individual in the lab has been given, and the accessioning department, which actually receives the samples, has been given a full PPE. So we are taking all the precautions proactively. But other than that, I don't have much more experience to share at this point of time. Maybe madam can, you know, add some more to that.
Ma'am, can you comment on the same in the hospital scenario where you are there? Because this is a very general question coming throughout the chat, which I could gather. I mean, most of the professionals and the people running the lab, and you being, recommended by the national healthcare system to conduct this testing and all. So probably they are more keen to understand how do they handle a routine sample coming to the lab.
Okay. So what we started, the virology lab was getting samples since February, but we started getting samples 7th March onward. So then the number of samples, confirmed COVID-19 sample patients, were less in number. So we took a decision that it has to be processed in a separate area. So we kept a dedicated CBC analyzer for it. We earmarked a separate area for it. So did the biochemistry people, the microbiology people. So separate areas, separate equipment for these patients, for these samples from the positive patients. So okay. When the patient, the sample comes to us, so and if only the CBC is required, then we don't have to open the vial, and it goes into the autoanalyzer with the cap piercing facility. So we are not, the technicians are not opening the vial if just the CBC is required, if no smear examination is required. So then it's a relatively low risk processing.
Okay.
But the biochemistry people, they have to separate the serum. So that was a area of concern. So then it was decided that we take full precaution, whatever lab the sample goes. So separate area, separate analyzer, separate machine for these sample, dedicated machine. And the person who is handling the samples, he wears the full protective gear except the N95 mask as of now.
Okay. Ma'am, there is one question for you. How did you go about an isolation area for collections? Because you have also been doing home visits. So in short, can you describe about how would you go about an isolation area when somebody has to do an screening, going for a screening test?
A very good question, actually, Prakash, that, we had to look at some of our locations and make sure that they are dedicated only for COVID-19 samples. And we were telling patients that this is not for any routine sample. So some of our centers were collection centers, so not our large centers. Our collection centers were then converted into COVID-19 centers, and they were only exclusively, or they are only exclusively doing sample collection for COVID-19. An innovative thing that we had done is that we have a mobile van, which we have converted into a mobile COVID-19 facility, which is currently parked in Mumbai at a location which is near Andheri Sports Complex. So that has seen a good response, we are also looking at when, there's a complete lockdown in a society, we are able to take that van, which has the entire setup, to go and do collection in a mobile, lab setup, so to say. So we've created seven fixed locations, which are exclusively COVID-19 centers. And one is the mobile van facility that we have created.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. And ma'am, there is one question which is coming and reflecting on the chat box. Is it like everybody is very much keen to know the role of hematological parameter as in co-viral marker? Like you mentioned about platelet lymphocyte ratio and as well as other inflammatory and infectious marker. So what is your comment on that?
So markers would be that these patients have lymphocytopenia, which is a remarkable thing, and they can show high platelet count, so which is commensurate with the acute phase reaction that these patients show up, as mentioned about the ferritin and procalcitonin and so on. So platelet reactive thrombocytosis can happen like because of that. So these kind of abnormalities. And another thing I chanced upon was that the earlier, I think the SARS epidemic, people mentioned that they didn't find the reactive lymphocytes in the peripheral smears, whereas the COVID-19 positive patients, they do show transformed lymphocytes or reactive lymphocytes in the peripheral smear.
I think we have a lot of questions and we can go on this, and with the time constraints and our other routine works to everyone, what we can do, you can log on, you can send in your feedback with the questionnaire at the email ID provided to you, hematology.hin@horiba.com. And with this, I would like to thank both the speakers to coming on the dais and talking and sharing their experiences at two different levels. But yes, hopefully this would be helpful to all the lab professionals. And thank you so much, Dr. Arora sir and Neelam Verma ma'am, to taking out time and on this very at a very short duration and a short notice with a very limited information of this infection which is there worldwide. And I would like to thank all the attendees who joined together putting up their questionnaires. We will be making the list of the questions, and you can share the same at hematology.hin@horiba.com. With this, I am logging off with a good health to every one of us, and taking care as in lab professionals, as healthcare professionals, we should take care of ourselves wherever we are working. So have a very healthy day ahead and coming in future. Thank you so much. Take care of yourselves and your beloved, and stay safe. Jai Hind.
Thank you, Prakash. Thank you, Prakash.
Thank you. Take care, everybody. Bye.
Thank you so much from the entire Horiba medical family to all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.